The demonstrations since George Floyd's death have focused a spotlight on racial injustices in American society. CBS News spoke with a number of activists about what it means to be anti-racist and why not being racist isn't enough to create change.
We'll just call it spade a spade. Saying I'm not a racist and being anti-racist is like two different things.
When most people think of racism, they think of, you know, let's say what happened to George Floyd, or they think of the KKK, or they think of slavery. And when that is kind of your perception, it's very easy to say, well, I would never do that. I would never do that awful thing, which is valid, but it's more nuanced than that.
Someone saying like, I'm not a racist, doesn't help the problem. Simply saying, I'm not doing that, does not save somebody's life. It's like witnessing someone getting jumped and being like, hey, I didn't jump him. It's like, but you also just stood there while he or she got jumped. And being an anti-racist is like, one, getting involved and being like, break it up, stop this. And two, speaking out to make sure it never happens again.
I would say on a very basic level, it's just about passive and active language, right? To say one is not racist doesn't actually connote any action. If you think about, let's pick baseball. To be not racist is going for a bunt. You know, you hold the bat out, the ball, you hope the ball hits the bat. You're not expecting to hit the ball hard. You just want to get the ball to connect with the bat so that you can attempt to make a play. To be anti-racist is to swing the bat as hard as you can and go for the home run. To put in the extra effort to shoot for the stars and to actually swing that bat, right? To risk the strike. To risk the strike, right? But you swing the bat as hard as you can every single time, right? Because you understand that that's the way you win games. That's the way you change things.
One of the most freeing things that white people can do, or actually any human being on the planet could do right now, is to just say, of course I'm racist. Of course I'm racist. If you grew up in a house that spoke French and you, as a baby, just started laying in your crib, listening to people speak French over you, you wouldn't have to do anything to start gaining proficiency in the French language. You would just speak it because that's what's being spoken around you. Our society speaks racism. It has spoken racism since we were born. Of course you are racist. Of course, the idea that somehow this blanket of ideas has fallen on everyone's head except for yours. Is magical thinking. It's useless.
Look, I think we celebrate the best of us, but I also think we had to live self-examined lives to mine and excavate the worst of us in order for there to actually be a good world, right? And I think that's what everyone's afraid to do.
The best way to get over stuff is to talk about it. This stuff will never change until people become comfortable having these uncomfortable conversations. On both sides. I mean, they're not comfortable conversations. I mean, I've had to have conversations with people in my family and I'm in an interracial relationship and, you know, having the conversation is not the easiest thing to do, but you have to do it.
It's really easy to kind of unintentionally create an echo chamber. A lot of us are friends with people who look like us and who have the same beliefs as us. But having these conversations, especially, you know, if you do have family members who, you know, harbor these like really, really toxic beliefs about Black people, rather than you talking about it with your fellow woke white friends, go talk to that relative.
That's the difference between non-racist and anti-racist. Is anti-racist is about action. That to do nothing is to leave the system firmly in place. It is to absolutely affirm the status quo of certain bodies being allowed resource access opportunities and other bodies being literally killed. So you're, you know, if you want to assure that racism stands, continue being non-racist. But if you would like to see racism dissolve, if you would like to see the interruption of racism, the interruption of white supremacy, then what you'll do is say, where do I speak French? And how do I translate that to a language that is less harmful? I think we all have the opportunity to do that right now.
To my allies out there, I'd say first and foremost, listen to your brothers and sisters who are Black, and then listen to yourself. Tap into you, who are you? And be honest about your biases, be honest about how you really feel when I come around. How would you really feel if your daughter brought home meat, or your son, or how many times you heard your parents say something racist and you let it slide because you figured it wasn't worth having the conversation? You know, like, these are the things, right? Or how many times you watch a television show and you laugh at something that you knew was actually not funny at all and could be harmful for other people in this world.
I want you to see it. I want you to actually feel it and understand that it's wrong versus just knowing that it's wrong. Because I can know so many things are wrong and still engage in wrong activity. But until I feel that it's, like, wrong, and until it like, bothers me to do these things, then I won't really be an effective participant in this.
I think there are a lot of people right now in this moment that are awakened in a new way. They're like, oh, I see some things that I just never saw before. Wow, you know, it's like the great white wokeness. And it's not enough to just be awake. You know, we wake up every morning, and if you adjust that in your bed once you were awake, nothing would get done. So when you wake up, you do something. Tiny things. I say, if you really are a person who's like, I believe everyone is equal. I believe everyone is equal. Is your bookshelf equal? Are the restaurants that you go to equal? Are the physicians and the professionals that you hire in your life, are they equal? Is your social media feed equal? Because yes, the more expansive your world is, the more people you start to think about. When someone says humans, you see an array of humans, not just white humans. And that is how we start to change things. Because if I can think about you on a conscious level, then your life really does matter. I will make sure that it actually matters.
And Sonya Renee Taylor joins me now. She's the author and founder of The Body Is Not an Apology. Sonya, thank you so much for being here. I want to start with that word, racism, because as you know, in some circles in our American culture, that word racism, or to be accused of being a racist, is nuclear. It can immediately trigger this defensiveness that shuts down any conversation, because there's this implication that a person willfully participated in the act of keeping someone else down because of the color of their skin. So how do we get past that?
So, first of all, thanks for having me today. I think that there are a couple of things that we have to tinker with inside of that. The first is that, yes, it creates this sense of defensiveness, this sense of I'm being attacked. And I think that part of that is because we have collapsed racism with morality. And I understand why we've done that. Like, it's like, oh, yeah, you're a bad person if you're racist. But I think that it doesn't hold the fact that racism is a theory, it is a set of ideas, it's a set of beliefs that are given to us. And lots of things are given to us. I get ugly sweaters from aunts at Christmas. I don't have to keep the ugly sweater. Right? And so if we can figure out how to diffuse the nature of assuming that racist means bad, means horrible person, then it actually frees us up to be able to explore where have I learned this set of beliefs, ideas, and ways of being as a result of the system that I live in, as a result of the world that I live in. And then how do I start returning these ugly sweaters I don't want? Because I don't want them.
But it's hard, though. I mean, as you know, I mean, that word has such power, and it can just completely cut off any chance of having an honest dialogue. But I like your ugly sweater comparison. That seems like a good idea. I might have to try that.
Yeah. And that we get to choose whether or not that word is nuclear. Again, I invite people to say, of course, I'm racist. I grew up in a society that was founded on chattel slavery. I grew up in a society that structurally said that certain people were not human, that they were only 3/5 of a human, and that we could enslave them. And then after we did that, I grew up in a society that said, okay, maybe you're human, but you're not human enough to sit at my countertops. You're not human enough to shop at the stores I shop at, eat at the restaurants that I shop at. And then we did that for another 5, 6, 7, 8 decades. It is, of course, we have seeped into these ideas. Of course they live inside of us. And as soon as we actually just give ourselves permission to say, I live in a world where racism exists and is taught and is the foundation of where I live, of course I have it. Where do I begin to excavate it? Where can I look inside of myself and say, but I don't want it, and let it go?
I mean, the reason I spend so much time on that, Sonya, is because, as you know, there are folks who, and I've had conversations with folks who say, well, there's always going to be racists in society, but this idea of systemic racism just doesn't make sense to me. That idea is something that I can't really wrap my head around. Is that the entry into that conversation, what you just went through, which is a, you know, summation, essentially, of our nation's history. And that's your entry point into that conversation?
Yes, it for me, and I, you know, I used this example in the clip that you shared, right, is that racism is a structure. It is a system of beliefs, ideas, policies, legislation, behaviors throughout time. Again, like you said, the history of the nation. And so I don't have to actively participate in creating that system to allow that system to stand. All I have to do is not tinker with it. But not tinkering with it makes me complicit. In the US, there are laws that say that if you are present when a person is murdered and you don't do anything, if you're present in the act of a crime, you don't have to be committing the crime. You just have to be around and not do anything, and you are equally complicit. There are people who are serving 10s, 20, 30 years in prison because they didn't do anything. That is the nature of not doing anything about racism. It's saying there's a structure and system that commits crime and harm against certain people's bodies, and I'm not doing anything which allows the crime and harm to continue. That makes me complicit.
So let me ask you about this concept of privilege, because I feel like that is another word that carries this power to, unfortunately, sometimes shut down a conversation as well. Help people understand what that term means, privilege, and why you believe it has to be part of these discussions on race.
So privilege is simply the unearned benefits that you receive from the world that you didn't have to think about. You don't consider them because you don't have to consider them. For example, I'm going to use the example of able-bodiedness as a privilege, because many of us are ambulatory. We walk on two legs. If you walk in a building and there's a flight of stairs, you just walk up the stairs and you get to where you're going. You don't consider it a privilege to be able to walk up the stairs. There are stairs, you have two legs, they work, you go up the stairs. That is a very different experience for someone who is a wheelchair user, who enters that building, sees a flight of stairs with no elevator, and then has no way to get up. The society that is created, again, based off of that history we just shared, that history that said certain bodies are not as valuable, certain bodies are not allowed to be here, certain bodies are not allowed to receive resource, means that certain bodies were, means that you were not going to be enslaved if you were white. You were not going to be denied a seat on a bus if you were white. You were not going to be denied a mortgage or access to the benefits of the GI Bill if you were white. And you don't think about that because you don't have to. It just is there for you. And you don't notice that it is not there for someone else because you're not intimately involved in their life. So part of the reason we can't see privilege is because we don't have other people in our existence who reflect privilege to us. They reflect, oh, I'm able to get something and my friend here wasn't able to get that. We are, our distance as a result of the way in which we segregate society keeps us from being able to be consciously aware of the ways in which privilege shows up.
All right. Well, Sonya Renee Taylor, these are difficult but long overdue conversations. Thank you for helping us start to figure out ways to navigate through together. Thanks so much.
Yeah, absolutely. Thanks so much for having me.